Welcome back to Torment. So last time, after I died, well, strangled in the mirror, and had that battle, I went to sleep, and in the night, there was another murder, and it was Crooked Keek. And I'm really sad about that, because I liked Crooked Keek. I do kind of wonder, if I had solved the murder mystery without ever going to sleep, would it be possible for me to keep Crooked Keek alive? Or is Crooked Keek's death necessary to advance the plot of the murder mystery? That's something I guess I could try to find out in a future playthrough. I'm not going to try to find out here. I'm not going to save Scum and go back and try to do this, you know, avoid sleeping. I don't really play that way anymore. I did in the past, especially when I was much younger, but as I got older, I kind of stopped doing that, and I just, whatever my choices are, if something unexpected happens and I choose something that doesn't work out the way I envisioned it, or something bad happens, or whatever, deal with it. I find it more enjoyable that way. Not to say that safe scumming is bad or anything, that's how you want to play, that's up to you. It's whatever you're up to. It's whatever you're down with. Alright, so I should go back down into the underbelly, since both I need to find out more about the murders. Two, I should... Oh wait, I have that. Boom. Is this what this lady over here was looking for? What's her name? Prada.
Why not?
Also, I know where the Changing Gods laboratory is now, so I can inform the cartographer dude. I guess not. Let's go into the underbelly. Okay. I thought that quest was basically just done. Here we go. Oh, that's to look for the, okay, the intro of her channel. Alright. Okay, so before I go into the underbelly, let me take a quick visit over to Cliff's Edge. He smiles as you approach him again. Ah! The Likely One is back, and you've returned a hero. I heard how you dealt with the Sticka. Fine work, he shakes his head. Sadly, the rogue Stickus we have been hunting here is still at large. I don't suppose you spotted it yet. I'm gonna be completely honest with him. I set it free. His eyes bulge. What? And you dare show your face? You're a traitor to your own kind. If any more houses fall, it'll be on your head. This is a tragedy, an outrage. I've half a mind to call the levies. I mean, they're standing right there, aren't they? Oh no, those aren't levies, those are just like your thugs. If fantastic opportunity gone. Such a pity.
Updated my journal.
Ooh, I got lots of experience. Did Calista just go up a level? Go back to your next bug lover. What they don't know is I actually stopped the houses from collapsing. Because I negotiated the stick of digging deeper. So, but whatever. I don't care if they know. Ah, so close. 14 more experience. Oh, she is up a level. Sweet. Ah, sweet. This will put her up a tier too. All right, extra effort. So I get both of these abilities. Dimensional power, while phased, gain +2 damage, okay? All other party members gain +5% on lore machinery tasks, +5% on lore mystical tasks, okay, so all lore details, that's cool, that's useful. Choose abilities to learn. Get two of these, entropic field. It confers vulnerable, armor reduction. Okay, so it strips armor. Is it an AoE or a single target? So it's action, active 3 rounds, esoteric attack. You create an energy siphoning vortex, weakening all within its radius. None can stand before you. Well, what's the size of the vortex? Doesn't say, but it's an AoE. Flash deals 8 physical damage to all enemies struck inside the radius. You do not miss, deal 1 damage for each level of effort applied. Again, doesn't tell you how big the radius is. Oh, well, range medium. That doesn't. Okay, that's just how far away I can cast it. Doesn't tell me that. Okay. And data sphere link. I'm gonna definitely get that. And enter the field. Sweet.
Learning begets doing. Or is it the other way? Yeah, that's something I could do. Doing begets learning.
Hey there, Mapper.
Yes.
Have you found it yet? Do you see with new eyes? Well, let's talk about something else first, anyway. Have you been to the Sticker Lair? I can tell you what's in there. Are you joking? Can you really? Tell me. He stares avidly at you, his blue prosthetic gleaming. As you speak, a space clears on his skin and new lines pull themselves to the surface. He moans as if the throes of deep pleasure. The Sticker Lair. Yes, like I was there. The eye clicks and whirls for a moment. And then he stares at the new tattoo. That smell. Did you notice the smell in the lair? Like lightning and dust. He smiles. My thanks to you. You've done right by me. So I've discovered the location of the Changing God Sanctuary. He leans forward, and the blue eye begins to gleam more brightly. Tell me about it, he whispers. As you speak, Mapper stares at the exposed patch of flesh on his arm. New lines etch into his skin, unfurling themselves across the space. He smiles tightly and shifts in his seat. Yes, he mutters. stars. Yes! He points to one light. Here, in the void beneath the city. What's this in the mural? He looks more closely and his arm recoils. Ah, God! It's terrifying even from here! He rubs at his skin as if trying to rid himself of the mural's image. His blue eye looks anywhere but at himself, and he shivers, bone deep. I don't envy you seeing that thing, friend. No, not at all. He slaps his face a bit, bringing some flush to cheeks, and smiles again. Anyway, I owe you a map, don't I? He takes a big breath and says, the White Death is hiding in a place called the Cave of Last Words. It's an old thief's bolt hole. They say Chila herself used it, but they don't say where it is. He smiles. Persistence pays, though. That's always been my watchword.
I'll remember that.
There's one way to get to it through the caravanserai, but it's sealed tight, and I never found a way in. But you can get there from the underground. The Stika know. They dug there. They can dig there again. Have you heard anything about the murders down here? Murders? What murders? Alarm crosses his face, and a faint red streak runs to his tattoos. No one tells me anything, he sighs. One of the drawbacks of being a drifter, I suppose. No one thinks to keep you informed. Then he looks around. Of course, in a place like this, people don't generally talk to each other much anyway. Skin hand rests palm down at the center of the huge pool of blood. On the nearby wall, someone has drawn a bloody circle pierced by jagged symbols. The skin hand at the center of the pool is small and misshapen. Nothing else remains of the victim. You study the dashes and bleeding pinpricks decorating, binding the circle. They aren't symbols in any known human tongue, but you sense their purpose. The circle was almost inconsequential. The sigil gripped the shape of it and pushed it through time and space. This was, however briefly, a transdimensional portal to another place. Now it's dead.
So, in this world, then.
Same thing it told me for. Oh, can I still fish though? Maybe I can get something out of there. Oh, I can't catch a fish for. Annie's fish. Heals 2 points of speed, sweetie. I can only do this once a day, right? Yeah. Oh, that's sad. I wish I could fish with Crooked Key.
Here I come!
He beckons at you. A hard, sharp motion. His jaw set. His teeth partly bared. Someone else was murdered in your absence, he says. A woman called Crooked Keith was killed beside the water. He turns his face from you. I ask that you share any new information that you have, and if you do not have any, find some. Do you have any new insight on the killer's motives? I do not. Weedle was a cornerstone of my plan for the city, he says, his voice tight. His death pains me and will hurt this city in years to come. He shakes his head slowly, tendons leaping in his neck. But Keek's death has only robbed the underbelly of her smile. I cannot imagine why she was targeted. The killer might be mistaken. Confused is more likely. Folsom seems like a strange name for you. Yes, the big man says. The name was a gift, and somewhat of a witticism. From my departed mentor many years ago. Before long, the name was the only one I was known by.
Sure.
Well, I suppose I should talk to the Stika. Chikak. How you doing? I'm looking for a way into a place called the Cave of Last Words. It's close to surface, at top of city, the creature pauses. Took another human there once. Probably the White Death. Chikek travel where Egg Friend want. We go.
Who are you?
Ah, there she is. This woman's skin is white, the color of alabaster or fresh ivory. Flat black eyes surrounded by sharply pointed features stare coldly at you. She wears jet black hair cut straight at the shoulders. Her clothes are functional and drab. Her cloak is fastened by a necklace of 5 canisters, each of different shape. She turns a black device over and over in her hands.
Where did you come from? How did you know where to find me?
Her startled expression becomes a dark glower. A keen blade flickers through her fingers. You're sure it wasn't there a moment ago. Did I invite him here? No, I wouldn't have done that. She leans in close to you. I wouldn't have thought it possible, but it appears we have found someone even more paranoid than poor Allegern. Oh, I'm not sure if I want to tell her that. I don't want Mappa to get killed. Is it really that important to know how I found you? Yes, because I need to know how to stop it from happening again. And if it means cutting some throats, it's no worse than I've done before. Like I'll do to... Wait, no. You're a cast-off. That wouldn't work. The knife disappears as quickly as it appeared. Her hand steals out and picks up a strange device again, almost of its own accord. She glances at your tattoo. How new are you? What were the circumstances of your birth? When did you happen? I was born as my body fell from an exploding moon. Ha! That bastard of a creator always finds a way to abandon us at the worst possible moment. Have you heard the stories of Tuck or Inifair yet? You should. What of them? She points her chin at your companions. If you think you can overpower me with mortals, you're mistaken. Oh, she is fascinating, isn't she? A wicked smile crosses her lips. What did you say? You're trespassing in my home, you know? Coming with a cast-off makes you more suspicious, not the other way around. Trust me, we mean no harm. I don't trust you. That's the problem. But fine. She flicks her hand and the knife disappears. Disemboweling you would just be a waste of time for me anyway. She turns back to her workbench and picks up the device again. Then she spits on the floor and scuffs at it with her boot, all nervous energy. So what do you want from me? I'm investigating some murders in the underbelly. Someone said they thought it was your work.
Making a note.
I've killed lots of people. Lots. In the underbelly? No. I don't think so. Do you want someone killed? She pauses. No. Wait. I could tell you, but my mind won't let me. I don't remember. If I were whole again. I heard you might know who can repair a device I found in the reef. Something called the resonance chamber. The resonance, a glint of understanding shines in her eyes. Ah, yes. Of course he would have hit it there. A crooked grin plays about the corner of her mouth and then vanishes. I know who can help you. Or did. She shakes her head. slips away. My mind has holes in it. One of our brothers took a rusty scalpel to my thoughts, my memories. I can't. She trails off. She catches a hold of the table, and it seems to anchor her. Her eyes harden.
I don't remember that.
No. No, you must do something for me. She caresses the black and jagged device knob that protruding with antenna. A sigil reminiscent of your tattoo is emblazoned on it. This is Tasha's mare caster. I want you to enter his mare and find out what you can about the jock. I'm convinced that's the key. What's a mare caster? Ha! Am I really the first one to say the word to you? Oh, you're in for a surprise, dear brother. Every cast-off has one, just like every cast-off has this. She taps the tattoo on your head. No one knows what they're for. Adiris used to think they were a byproduct of the transfer process, just like us. She seems lost in thought for a moment. Then she shakes her head. Wherever they came from, they can be used like a kind of temporal viewer. You relieve an event in the life of the cast-off whose mare caster it is. That event is called a mare. What is a jock? You don't know? I thought it was a common instrument. No, it might not be so much anymore. One of the curses of a long life, she laughs raggedly. Fashions come and go before you even know they exist. Probably easier just to let them go. Or make new ones of your own, like some of the other cast-offs. Sorry. No, not sorry. You should know this. You should know about things. History. That's what life is. Knowing and doing. Matkina, you need to focus. Tell him what he needs. She breathes deeply. Chak is an ancient woodwind, and this one was kept in a sealed cave behind massive doors from a prior world. It had powers, but I can't remember what those powers were. If the jock is a key, what does it unlock? Her brow furrows, confused for a moment. She curses. If I knew that, I wouldn't need your help, would I? She lets out a long sigh. He stole that memory from me, all right? If he can find it for me, it'll all come back. All of it. So, how do I enter a mirror? An almost palpable hunger fills her eyes, a yearning. Hold the mare caster. You'll feel the tug immediately. Don't resist. Empty your mind and let the tides pull you into the mare caster. She collects herself. Then just watch him. Watch for the jock. When you see what he's done with it, pull your mind away from Tasha's and tell me what you saw. Oh, and don't try to change anything, she says, almost as an afterthought. Why shouldn't I try to change anything in the mirror? What did she mean by that? Nothing serious, she says. She says it as though speaking to an overly concerned child. She laughs suddenly. It's not like you can change the past, but I need you to learn a specific piece of information. If you change something, then you might go the wrong way. All right, let's do it. She plucks Tasha's marecaster from the table. She looks at it, at you, and back at the device. She licks her lips as if weighing her options. And then, before she can hesitate anymore, slaps it into your hands. It's surprisingly heavy. Do it, she says, her voice heavy. Find the jock. Bring me my answers. Focus on the device, and you feel something tugging at your mind. Oh, it's like a choose your own adventure now? Oh, sweet. Everything is wrong. Tasha's body, yours now, clings like a wet cloak. The world is too bright for nighttime. Everything is too clear. Distance is too close. Edges too sharp. Memories like blood flies buzz about your head, whizzing away before you can catch them. Hard-ridden anemone heave their flanks and huff behind you. Like you, they've gone too long without rest. And there's Matkina, a much newer, not Keenan, as drawn by a pandering portraitist. Too soft, too fresh, too pretty. All wrong. On the wastes, you see the light of campfires, and in the humble village before you, a bigger, brighter fire burns. It's a pyre inside a body that's too large, burns too slowly. Greasy coils of smoke rise into the night. Villagers circle the bonfire, wailing and shaking. The headman's rough voice continues the ritual. From exile, you are released. Among the mourners, some echo, "You are released." He throws a handful of powder into the fire, metal salts perhaps, and a spray of shiny embers rises into the night. Mostly gold, some green, some purple. From Raph, "You are released," they echo him. As the embers flow out toward the plains and fade among the stars and campfires, you hear Mapkina whisper reverently, "You are released." A big pool to work with. Let's do it. You squint your unnatural eyes and focus until the pyre, the village, everything else fades away. At last, the blurry campfires resolve into something crisper, and you see the faint shadows of men around them. Men in long coats and broad hats, painstakingly cleaning their jazails and daggers. There are perhaps 100 of them. Mapkina sees you staring and grunts. Sandbites. From her tone, it's obvious that they're no friends of hers or yours. As the body burns and the mourners chant, you wait in the shadows at the edge of the village. At last, the corpse is consumed and the headman gives a final cry. "To the distant dark, you are released." The villagers echo him, then drift away, leaving him alone beside the smoldering pyre. Mapkina, with a hiss and a gesture, leads you over. He sniffs the air at the sound of your approach and, with a broad smile, calls out, "Keena!" His eyes are large, milky marbles. He puts his hands on his shoulders. "You returned in unpleasant times." She touches his cheek. "I return because the times are unpleasant, Meng." Without another word, the three of you leave from the fire and enter Meng's dark hut. Meng's home is humble and small, hardly furnished and wholly undecorated. On entering, he lowers his weary bulk onto a hassock and gestures toward a similar cushion, towards similar cushions for you and Mapkina. Then begins without preamble. "They hung him from a tree. Old Garet took their daggers to him, called it pruning. Blind to others' expressions, he has become oblivious to his own, and he wears his pain and anger nakedly. With a grunt, he continues, "They sent him home by skimmer, along with the compact they made to the plains people." He waves at the crumpled sheet of paper on the floor. "Tick, read it to me." "They've promised to put an end to our menace, Keena." He shakes his head. "Why? We've always paid the blood price for whatever harm we've done. You know that. They know that." "Yes," Keena says softly. "But the Sand Knights won't take shins. You know that," he grunts. "The militia is here to help, Meng. You are who we stand for. The small, the threatened, the hunted. That's who we are, too." She shakes his hand. "Come away. If you tell the knights you're going, they won't force a fight. They have bigger battles ahead of them. Believe me. This is our place, Keena. Patch Reckon will give you a home. Trust her." Nang is silent. You unfold the compact sent by the Sand Knights. The writing is neat, plain, small, and seems to go on and on, tightly stacked lines. In essence, it is a vow to safeguard the villages and towns of the Verxulian Waste from the menace in Kohl Village. The Knights promise that they will undertake steps to assure that the killers in Kohl Village never harm anyone again. Extermination is never mentioned, merely implied. Beneath the Knight Marshal's chap, are signatures from various burghers, mayors, and elders of towns and villagers of the Waste. The Knights ask nothing in return from them. The signatures vow nothing, they merely endorse, justifying whatever the Knights undertake. The world is full of places, Ben. This hill of yours is nothing special. He heaves a heavy sigh. Maybe that's true, stranger. This hill, this village, it's no more our home than anywhere else in the world. Then he shakes his head. But we can't just go, Makina answers, her voice soft but insistent. Nay, I know this is your home. It was my home, too. But it's not safe here. Patch Reckon has set aside land for all of you, deep inside our territory, where we can protect you. It's not so simple, he answers. Not so easy. Plains people cannot understand. Makina hisses in frustration and gives you a look. It seems she's hoping you can move this stubborn old fool. The only time it's too late to start a new life is when you're dead. Give your people a chance to survive. Nang nods slowly. You're right, of course, even if you've got the manners of a marked marauder. After a minute, he turns his blind eyes to Makina. But we can't go without the jack. The what? Makina asks. Up the hill, behind the gate. The cave's been sealed for generations. Inside is the jack. It's what helps us keep our worst instincts inside. If we leave its song, he trails off, gesturing to the pyre outside. He sniffs the air, then nods his head again. I'll tell you now how to open the gate. He describes how each lock must be disarmed, repeating it until he's sure you both remember. Now, he says, you alone of the plains people know how to open the gate. You work your way up the terrible hillside, leading Nang to make his case to his people. In the distance, you see that the Sand Knights are on the move, riding hard toward Kohl Village. Nang will need to make his case to them, too. When you arrive at the cave and its huge ancient gateway, Makina shakes her head. For years I wondered about this, she says. The hill people tell a fable that the first men and women came out of here. They said the gate would only open when it was time for people to disappear. She shrugs. One way to keep kids from poking around and disturbing the jack, I guess. Something she said stirs your mind, and your memories jingle like a wind chime. I guess I need to go all out to have a decent chance. At once, a glaring light shines over your mission, as painful as it is revealed. Good thing I had a big intelligence pool to start with here. You're not here to help Patch Reckon save Kohl Village. You're here to help Patch destroy it. She knew the villager's secret, knew about the jack. Most importantly, she knew the Sand Knights would come, knew about their compact. The plan isn't to take the villagers out of the Knights' way. In fact, it depends on causing the very battle that Kina promised would be averted. When the Knights arrive, Patch will destroy the jack, forcing the hill people into their feral state, unleashing them upon the Knights, weakening one of the malicious foes. And Patch is coming in person to see that all goes right. No, I'm not here to alter things. After you. Akina shrugs and quickly disarms the dozen ancient locks that have long kept the cavern sealed. With a gasp, the gate opens, and without waiting, she steps through. You follow. What you find within is no cave tunnel. In fact, there's no stone at all. Rather, it's a smooth hallway made of greenish, phosphorescent ceramic. Under its glow, you and Akita take on the look of unburied dead. There seems to be no side passages, no chambers, merely a single path that curls ever inward, like you are in the shell of some great nautilus. From time to time, the walls are adorned with lifeless ciphers, arcane charts, even scorch marks as if from a struggle. They tell no tale for you to hear. At last, you reach the tunnel's end, and there on the pedestal before you is what must be the job, a kind of reed flute that plays an endless, formless song, at once almost too faint to hear and too haunting to bear. Whether the music is caused by the breeze blowing through the tunnel or by the jack itself is impossible to determine. The ceramic pedestal beneath it, alone of all the devices in the cave, still pulses with living energy. That energy causes the jack to float a fraction of an inch in the air. It doesn't rest on the pedestal so much as hang above it. So, says Matkina, here it is. While the jack and the wistful wind-blowing notes is what you came for, it is the pedestal that draws your attention first. Hidden within, some secret mechanisms holds the jack aloft, untouched and motionless. As for the jack, you get the sense that there is more than the music to mere wind over pipes. Not just tones behind your hearing range, but that perhaps forces beyond sound itself. A deeper harmony that resonates in more than the tiny bones of the inner ear. What do you think this place is? Matkina shrugs. Could be anything. You're the one who always says a person will go crazy trying to understand the world. But from the way she holds a little breath in as she ends the sentence, it's clear that she can't stop there. Crazy or not, she wants a meaning to it. I think the hill people must have come from here, she says. Or maybe come through here. She shrugs again. But we're not here to find the answers. We're here to get that. She points at the jack. All right. The moment your hand closes around the jack, a shiver ripples through your body, a physical premonition of the agony that swiftly follows as the pedestal's booby trap is triggered. You can neither release the jack nor pull it free. Indeed, cannot move at all except to shudder as violent energy courses through you. Tash! Akina cries. The split second before she responds seems a lifetime, as if it could have been where her reflexes were not so honed. She slams herself into you, breaking the circuit even as the current passes into her. The two of you lie trembling and smoking on the ceramic floor. Akina rises first, pulls you to your feet, and takes the jack. Let's go. She runs. They're waiting for you at the gate. A woman you immediately know to be Paj Rekin and her bodyguard, a half dozen tattooed cast-offs with drab armor, mismatched weapons, and the languid readiness of predators. Past them in the village below, you see the Sand Knights have arrived and are meeting with Nang and the villagers. Without warning, one of the bodyguards lowers his weapon at Akina and fires, but she's already moving and takes a glancing blow. A knife is in her hand as another glaive aims a new device. Before Akina can fling her blade, she's frozen, trapped in shimmering energy. Paj herself aims a tiny cipher at the jack. The others watch, paying you little mind. What are you doing? As you try to speak, Paj raises her empty hand, and such is the force of her will that you fall silent. Without pausing, she activates the cipher she's holding in her other hand, and a thin beam shoots forth. The jack simply disintegrates. In the village, chaos explodes. Where once Nang and his hill people stood, there's now a writhing mass of tentacled things, which fall upon the Sand Knights. Caught off guard, a dozen knights die instantly. Others open fire. Inside the energy field, Matkina trembles with rage. Her burning eyes flick between you and Paj. Paj sighs. This is an unfair way to reward friends, Paj says, but one must secure victory and make amends later. She points to the slaughter below. Those Sand Knights are irreplaceable. With a single stroke, we've shifted the balance of power in the Vexulian Waste and loosened our enemy's iron grip from 24 villages. You've served the militia well. What have you done? Paj gives you an incredulous look, glances at Matkina, then shakes her head. You know exactly what I've done, and why I've done it, Paj. There's no need to pretend otherwise. She looks again at Matkina, who's screaming silently inside her bubble. Even Matkina knows why. Paj approaches the energy field and holds out a hand as if to touch it, to touch Matkina. Love is a wild beast that must be tamed. Matkina, tamed and trained to serve. Let it buck if it must, but in the end, you must break it before you are thrown. Now what? Now you wipe Matkina's mind. We release her, and we see whether she finds her way home to us, where she belongs. That should be within your power, within Tasha's power, anyway. When the tide surges through him, he can destroy memories, the same way you use the tides to escape the sorrow in your mind. But for all you've become accustomed to wearing his body, you feel no special attunement to the tides, no sense of power over others' memories. In fact, within this mirror, you hardly feel the tides at all. Again, she told me not to try to change anything, so... You have no idea how to wield the tides as Tash would. It's not a power that resides in his body, which you've stolen, but in his essence, which you've shunted aside. You can only try to achieve the same result by guesswork. You focus your mind and gaze upon Matkina, willing away to wipe her memories clean. Matkina meets your stare, and her eyes have a clarity and a half. Vacancy that you've seen, that Tash has seen, before she kills. She's past anger now, and come to cold revenge. But whatever wishes lie behind your gazes, nothing happens. You cannot cause a tidal surge through the Marecaster. You cannot wipe her memories. Paj looks at you impatiently. This is not the time for dallying or playing games, Tash. We need to leave before the Sand Knights finish the villagers and turn their guns on us. Fine, I'll do it. You're only seconds into your ruse when Pasha's face darkens, perhaps with anger, perhaps with disappointment, perhaps with outrage that she would attempt such a sham. Whatever the case, she lifts a finger, and before you can react, you are sliced open by one of the bodyguards. As you fall to the ground, filleted and unable to move, you watch them fling Matkina over the cliff. Still wrapped in her energy field, she can't even scream. Paj gives you a last annoying glance, then leads the others away. You cannot see where they go. Darkness gathers around your vision, and a sound like crashing waves fills your ears. And then you slough off Tasha's body, Tasha's mind, and all goes black. I'm ready to learn something. As your consciousness rises from the shadows of the mirror, something clicks in your mind. Something has changed deep inside you. But what? Matkina stares at you, the shock painfully obvious on her face. What? What did you do? I remember Tash cutting me. I see the holes in my mind. I remember him forcing me to the ground, tearing out my history with his tides. But I have other memories now. They're real. He didn't do it. He died. He didn't violate me. He joined the first. But he did try, didn't he? She holds her head in her hands, shaking, her voice becoming thick. The two strands of memory. This is pulling me apart. She looks up at you, tears streaming down her cheeks. No. It's pulling me back together. I remember now. That hole is... it's almost gone. You changed reality. You changed it. She stands, drying her tears with her sleeves. I don't know if you meant to do that, but you've done more than your part of the deal. You asked about the resonance chamber. I know it. Nazov's the guy you want. He can fix anything. He might have even helped design the chamber you're talking about. Your best bet is to look for him in the cast-off sanctuary. Miel Abbas. There's a cast-off sanctuary? It's a sanctum, a refuge, created by the First and our Sire. It's shielded from the sorrow, supposedly. She shrugs. Our siblings like to hide there, until they can't stand each other's company anymore. Personally, I don't think anywhere is safe from the sorrow, not even that place. Great, where can I find Miel Abbas? Word of caution. They won't believe you in Miel Abbas. They'll treat you like they treat every new cast off, as a pawn in their games with each other. Look out for that. She walks to her table and unrolls a map of the Saga's Protectorate. You're not going to find it by walking there. The entrance is a secret, known only to our kind. Here. She points to a spot in the map, many kilometers to the northeast of Saga's Cliffs. The Valley of Dead Heroes. There's a hidden portal in the necropolis. Also, memorize this. She writes the numbers 3431 down on a slip of paper. Holds it in front of your eyes for several seconds, then crumples it in her hand. It's a code. It'll make sense when you get to the necropolis. You'll need an airship to get to the valley. The ladder over there leads up to the caravanserai. You should be able to hire a ship without too much difficulty. Thank you. Can I ask some other questions? Fine, do what you want. What can you tell me about this place? This is the Cave of Last Words. It was a thieves' hole until the tunnel leading in collapsed. 500-600 years ago, it was where the scum of the city would slip away from the city guard, before there were levies, before the slave families. The truly desperate lawbreakers fled here when they had no other option. That, there, that's the suicide tunnel, she points. The words on the cave walls, those are the final words of people with nothing left to lose, etched into the bedrock of the city, burned in and burned out by the hopeless. A fitting metaphor. She looks at you appraisingly. If you question the worth of your life, these terminal thoughts are instructive. For a long time, they helped me hang on. I almost wrote my own words there many times. Not that diving off a cliff would have ended me. And then there's a ledge at the end of the tunnel, just in case those words are inspirational. Her crooked grin resurfaces. The view is also quite nice. What's the story with you and the other castoffs? She gives you a long, slow look. You were in the mare. You saw what happened. I wanted to make a difference, and they pissed on my hopes. After that debacle, I killed Tash and fell out with the rest of them. She frowns. The conflict between the First and the Changing Gods swallows all our siblings, one way or another. I didn't want that. I wanted to make my own way. They weren't pleased, and here I am. No worse for the lack of their company.
I'll remember that.
I haven't killed anyone in the underbelly for years. There's no money in it, no fear. She crosses her arms. I've got a style, a reputation to maintain. She pauses. But if you found any clues at the scene, let me know. I admit, I'm curious who would do a job in that hole. I did find a clue in the underbelly murders. A circle containing a triangle bearing a bleeding eye, with another triangle breaking the circle from the right.
Making a note.
She shudders. The Children of the Endless Gate, a splinter sect of the Dedra O'Hur. Both of them gifts to the world from our beloved siblings. The Dedra are mostly harmless, disgusting as they are, worthless as their creator is. They have a chapel in the underbelly. Go talk to them. What can you tell me about the Changing God? brilliant, charming, and ruthlessly self-centered. More blood on his hands than I'll ever have. Legend says he wiped out the Tabat, a nearly complete genocide. He left one alive as an object lesson. One of their generals enslaved in the city to teach his enemies not to cross him. Who's the first? The first cast off. She was, or she claimed to be. She's dead now. She said she'd fight for us all. They say she was the one who founded Miel a vest for our sakes. Most of our siblings remember her as a hero. She spits in the corner. Most of them never actually knew her. She was driven, I'll give her that. Even with her decaying body, with all its hurts and wounds, she found masks to cover herself and the strength not to hurt. And she kept plowing on. How many castoffs are there anyway? She shrugs. Hundreds? Who knows? Supposedly the changing god went to other worlds, met time and space, slipped through dimensions, and he has always had his spare bodies with him. There could be thousands, millions for all I know. How did you find this place? I listened to the stories of old thieves. I went to the Bloom and listened to the stories of Chila. I made friends with the Sticka, and I asked them if they knew a place like this. Turns out they did. Would you travel with me? Too many of you already. Don't want to join the menagerie. Maybe after you drop them off. Oh, so I can get her as a companion if I tell one of my other companions to beat it. I kind of like my group, though. But that's something to think about. Alright, I got some level ups. Let's increase an ability or skill. Hold on. What would I want to increase? I could increase Onslaught. I want to. Well, if I do an ability, maybe I can learn a new ability that way. One way to find out. Nope, I could increase Onslaught. Oh, that's the remembering thing. That would be useful. I use that a lot. Cipher use. To do endurance. That would get rid of the penalty. Initiative, lore machinery. Natural persuasion, smashing.
My understanding has increased.
There we go. Am I going up a level again? I went up two levels. Nice. Alright, extra effort.
Need rest.
So get inspiring presence. Your allies within short range gain inspired at all times. Nice. It's an aura. Alright. I guess this is because I'm gold tied. Plus 5% shins earned from selling items, minus 5% cost. Okay, that's useful. I get two from, wow, that's a lot of stuff to choose from. Resourceful, mind barrier. Okay, it's useful. Although my intellect pool's already pretty damn big, but can energize. Innervate. I could get the data sphere link also. Okay. Flash. I don't really know what that is. Adaptation. Targeting eye. Alright, so let's get the mind barrier. wouldn't be a bad idea.
Just what I needed.
Alright, rinse up a level. Increase the stat pool. Add extra effort. Ooh, I could increase her might. Oh, no, I can't. Alright, she's stuck with one might no matter what I do. Increase her speed or intellect. I think intellect is the way to go.
Feeling good about this.
Emeritus. Ability or skill. Now. Stat pool. Yeah, I think I'm going to increase his might. Increase his edge again in might.
Feel even more fantastic.
All right. So before I leave this place, let's take a look around. The clay containers smell of cheap wine and spoiled food. A dirty wash basin sits atop a barrel of stagnant water.
Yes.
Loot. Father Teller. The small polished disc looks like a handheld mirror, but anyone who looks in it sees an image of their father or their species equivalent, looking back at them, mirroring their every move. When you hold it, though, all you see is your own face. That makes sense, actually. I could interact with it. Final words of countless men and women are scrawled upon the stone walls. Some apologize to loved ones, while others rage against an injustice or a slight.
In an instant.
A few only leave their names. I can leave through this way, huh? Does that mean jumping to my death? Or will this put me on the ledge? There I am. Well, she wasn't lying. That's a ledge. Doesn't seem like there's anything to do there.
In an instant.
And this pit here. Is this where I came from? Where the sticker brought me? The hole in the corner is large, about 2 meters across. It was clearly carved, but not by human hands. It leads into a dark tunnel. You know that it was dug by the sticker and leads to the underbelly. But I could also leave this way. Though weathered, the rungs of this ladder are firm and strong. At the top of the ladder, you can see a closed hatch and can also discern the levers that hold the hatch snugly closed. Aha! So now that's a quick way to get back there. Alright, excellent. Cool, we'll leave off here, and I guess we gotta get an airship now is the next step, but I'm also gonna go, there's some other things I need to take care of in town, I think, before I try to leave.